Bem, bom dia, pessoal. Vamos começar mais um seminário de teoria dos números. Obrigado por vocês pelo esforço de participarem aqui nesse horário diferente, às 10 horas da manhã. Mas eu digo a vocês que vai valer a pena esse esforço extra que estamos fazendo. Thank you everyone for participating in this number theory seminar. Today is the 15th of September of 2021, and we have the pleasure of having Professor Soydan with us from Bursa Uludag University, and he's going to talk about some recent results on Diophantine equations with power sums. Thank you, Gökhan, for accepting our invitation.
Bom dia a todos. Good morning, everybody.
Bom dia, bom dia.
Bom dia, bom dia. First of all, I would like to thank to for Professor Emar Godinho for kind invitation. My name is Gökhan. I'm working at Bursa Uludağ University as a full professor since 2013. Bursa is the name of the city in which I live. I would like to give a short information about Bursa. Bursa is the third big city of Turkey. Its population is about 2.5 million. Bursa is a big industrial city. It has two car factories, and Bursa is the heart of textile industry in Turkey. Uludağ is the name of a mountain in Bursa. Ulu means huge, big. Dağ means mountain. This mountain is about 2,500 meters. Bursa Uludağ is the biggest ski center of Turkey during the winter, and also Bursa is 25 kilometers far from seaside. Bursa is very close to Istanbul. It takes 2 hours by ferry. Bursa has a rich history. In the old times, Bursa was capital city of Ottoman Empire, so there are many historical places from Ottoman time in Bursa. I would like to show you some pictures from Bursa. Here is the main gate of our campus. This is the part of our university campus. This building is our faculty building. Mathematics department is here, first floor. Here is mathematics department. You see Uludağ in winter time. Yes, Bursa is far from, Bursa is 25 kilometers far from sea. Mudanya, here is Mudanya. Mudanya is town of the Bursa.
Gökhan, the slides are not changing.
Sorry?
We are only seeing your first slide of the main entrance of the university.
Really?
You are presenting other slides, I believe, isn't it? But this is the only one we are seeing.
Is it okay?
Yep, but we are only seeing the slide from the main entrance. Well, now you are looking at your presentation.
Okay. Now, is it okay?
Yes, 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 yes. Thank you.
Okay. Here is our faculty building, Faculty of Science. This is mathematics department. Uludağ during the winter. Mudanya is town of Bursa. It's far from 25 kilometers. Here is also Mudanya. These are old houses. Uludağ and city center. Yes, Kavurt Pazar, like in Istanbul, Gölyazı is a center of Bursa, as you see. This is a big tree. It has 500 years old. Okay.
Well, thank you for this slide. Beautiful city.
It's time to talk about mathematics. Is it okay? My screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Okay.
My talk is about some recent results on the Diophantine equations with power sums. Firstly, I will introduce Bernoulli numbers and Bernoulli polynomials. Then I will show the connection between Bernoulli polynomials, Bernoulli numbers, and Diophantine equations with power sums. Next, I will introduce Schaeffer's conjecture, and I will give some progresses on his conjecture. Then I will talk about my old and new results on two Diophantine equations with power sums. Finally, I will give my new results on the power values of the sum of three squares in arithmetic progression. Okay. In his posthumous book, Ars Conjectandi, published in, actually, I would like to give some fundamental notions for graduate students. Maybe they can be interested in power sum Diophantine equations. So I will give some topics, some notions, fundamental notions. Okay. Jacob Bernoulli introduced the Bernoulli numbers in the connection to the study of the sum of powers of consecutive integers. After listing the formulas for the sum of powers, we know this formula from high school, you know. Bernoulli expressed the right-hand side without factoring. I will show you. He gives a general formula involving the numbers which are now today as Bernoulli numbers. Bernoulli then explains how these numbers are determined inductively and emphasizes how his formula is useful computing for the sum of powers. He claims that, yes, he claims that he did not take a half of quarter of an hour to compute the sum of 10 powers 1 to 1000, which he computed correctly as this number. This is a big number. The year is 1713 or before. Using modern notation, his formula is written with this expression. This is power sum e from 1 to n, e to the key is equal to this expression. Bj is the Bernoulli number. Bernoulli number is given by this recurrence formula, as you see. Japanese mathematician Seki Takakazu. In general, we know that Bernoulli found or Bernoulli introduced Bernoulli numbers, but at the same time, Japanese mathematician Seki Takakazu published also posthumously in 2012, and thus 1 year before Bernoulli, the formula for the sum of powers and the inductive definition of the Bernoulli numbers are given. His formula and definition are completely the same as Bernoulli's. Since this discovery, the Bernoulli numbers have appeared in many important results, including the series expansion of trigonometric and hyperbolic trigonometric functions, the Euler-Maclaurin summation formula, the evaluation of Riemann zeta function, and Fermat's last theorem. I would like to give a reference for young researchers. I mentioned here that a very extensive bibliography on Bernoulli numbers compiled by Carl Dilscher, who is Canadian mathematician. It is available online, this website. You can find detail about these numbers. A sequence of Bernoulli numbers is given with this recurrence relation. The first few Bernoulli numbers, BQ, are given as follows using this formula. And the generating functions, here Bn is Bernoulli number, not this is generating functions for Bernoulli numbers. The connection between Bernoulli numbers and Bernoulli polynomials is given with this relation, Bernoulli polynomials, Bernoulli numbers, Bk. The first few Bernoulli polynomials, Bq, are given as follows, as you see. One of the most powerful applications of Bernoulli numbers, the evaluation of the Riemann zeta function. Let k be a real number which satisfies this condition. Then Riemann zeta function over real numbers, zeta k, is defined with this formula. This function is important for many reasons, but we will highlight one result proven by Euler related to the prime numbers. This formula. For k is greater than 1, zeta k is given with this formula over all primes p. Bernoulli numbers help us to calculate the even values of this function. For any integer k is greater than 1, zeta 2 k is given with formula. You see Bernoulli numbers in this formula. Riemann zeta function is more famous as a complex function with powers key in the complex plane. In 1859, Bernhard Riemann hypothesized a result related to the complex Riemann zeta function, namely that all of its non-trivial zeros lie on this line. The conjecture has never proven and remains one of the great unsolved problems of mathematics. Mathematicians and mathematical physicists have developed a whole branch of mathematics contingent on the fact that the hypothesis is true, so that anyone who manages to uncover the proof will immediately verify thousands of results. Now, we look at an application of the Bernoulli numbers to one of the great solved problems of mathematics, the simply states Fermat's last theorem. This theorem says that this equation has no integer solutions x, y, z for positive integers and is greater than 2. And Kummer's result was the product of another mathematician's mistake. German mathematician Ernst Kummer had spent little time on Fermat's theorem, which he considered a curiosity of number theory rather than a major item until March 1847, when the French mathematician Gabriel Lame published a complete proof of the theorem. Not this theorem, I will show you. Lame's main contribution was notizing this sum could be decomposed into factors involving the n roots of unity. This was a useful step. However, he incorrectly assumed that this factorization was unique in Q zeta p, but Kummer himself had proven years prior that this was not the case. Kummer felt compelled to respond, and a few weeks after Lame's publication, he had a proof for a select group of integers and that would satisfy Fermat's last theorem. He called them regular primes. Okay. Odd prime p is regular prime if the class number of q zeta p is relatively prime to p. Note that by definition, a class number is the order of the ideal class group z zeta p. But more intuitively, the class number can be understood as a scalar quantity describing how close elements of a ring of integers are to having unique factorization. If the class number is 1, then the ring has unique factorization. For positive values greater than 1, the closer to 1, the class number is the closer to having prime factorization. Kummer proved an equivalent definition, which almost by magic involves the Bernoulli numbers. A regular prime p is an integer such that it does not divide the numerator of these Bernoulli numbers. Kummer proved Fermat's last theorem for all regular primes. This, of course, begs the question, how many regular primes are there? We know that the first irregular prime is 37, because you see this Bernoulli number has the factor 37. Beyond that, we know that there are infinitely many irregular primes, but it is not known if there are infinitely many regular primes. Computational studies have shown that about 60% of primes are regular, and German mathematician Carl Ludwig Siegel has conjectured that the exact proportion converges to this number. However, neither hypothesis has been confirmed. Regardless, Kummer's early work into Fermat's last theorem paved the way for mathematicians of the 20th century to finish off the problem. Okay. Now we are going back to the Diophantine equations with power sums. I will introduce Schaeffer's conjecture, and I will give some results about Schaeffer's conjecture. In 1875, the classical question was this. This equation has only the solutions. But Lucas did not answer this question completely. In 1918, Watson proved that this equation has no solution other than these solutions. Okay. Now we consider this Diophantine equation. SKX is a polynomial, its degree is k, and is greater than or equal to 2. The right hand side y to n. The relation between Bernoulli polynomials numbers and SKX is given with this formula. According to Schaeffer's lemma, we can factorize SKX if k is greater than 1 and k is odd, SKX has fixed factors, as you see, x plus 1. If k is greater than or equal to 2 and k is even, they are fixed factors. RKX is a polynomial with integer coefficient. Schaeffer proved that this equation has at most finitely many solutions in positive integers x and y, where k is greater than 1 and n is greater than 2 or equal to 2. But in this case, this equation has infinitely many solutions because this equation is reduced to Pellian equation. Schaeffer approached this equation in terms of computational part. He proved that this equation he solved for this case. Schaeffer solved for this case. In the terminology of his works, this was called S trivial solution. Another solution was called as non-trivial solution. Okay, this is Schaeffer's conjecture. Let k is greater than or equal to 1 be fixed, and let suppose that n is greater than or equal to 2. This equation has only non-trivial, so this non-trivial solution. This conjecture has not been proved yet completely. This is still open problem. But there are some progresses about this equation. For example, 2003, Jacobson, Pinter, Walsh solved this equation for the case n is equal to 2, k is equal to 2. Only this case. And also, k is smaller than or equal to 58. Next year, Bennett, Gurry, and Pinter, using modular approach, they showed that this equation has only the trivial solution, but k is bounded and is general. They proved this result about Schaeffer's conjecture. 11 years later, a new progress on Schaeffer's conjecture was recorded by Lajos Hajdu, who is a Hungarian mathematician. We first recall that VPN stands for the exponent of the prime p in the prime factorization of the positive integer n. Okay, Hajdu gave this formula, V2 periodic valuation, V2 SKX. And then Hajdu gave V3 SKX. Then using these lemmas, V2 SKX and V3 SKX polynomial, he proved that this equation, Schaeffer's equation, has only known solutions, but x is smaller than 25 and x is congruent to 0 or 3 in modulo 4. Only this case. And next year, Berzesh, Hajdu, Miyazaki, and Pink proved that all solutions of this equation, x is smaller than 25 with this condition. They removed this condition, only this condition. They proved this equation has no new solution. Then Schaeffer's conjecture is true. They proved that, or they confirmed that Schaeffer's conjecture is true. Okay. Now, I will consider, firstly, I will consider my result, my old result, 4 years ago. I consider this polynomial, TKLX, is equal to y to n. So we are interested in this equation. First work was done by Bai and Zhang, 2013. They solved this equation for the case k is equal to l is equal to 2, only this case. In my old result, I proved that this equation has finitely many solutions. In my first result, says that n can be bounded, which the, with C1 is effectively computable constant, depending only on L and K. The second result is more general. This result says that this equation finitely many solutions because x, y, n can be bounded a fixed number. But here I proved for the case L is even, L is even. 3 years later, namely last year, I proved the case L is odd with my colleague. I will show you. Okay. The another case, key is 1, key is 3, and N is 2. This case correspond to Pellian equation. This means in this case, this equation has infinitely many solutions. Okay. We need some lemmas. As you see, this polynomial can this polynomial is equal to this expression. This expression includes Bernoulli polynomial. As you see, and another important result, if you are interested in a power sum equation, you need this result. If you prove that a power sum equation has finitely many solutions, you need this result. It is very useful. Hx is a polynomial, its degree is n. These are factors. Its factors are simple or multiple root. Here we define Ti. This result was given by Bela Brinza, who is Hungarian mathematician. Here, Ti number is important. M over GCD M Ri. Ri is multiple of the root. Suppose that T1 blah blah, Tn is not a permutation of the n tuple. This shape. I called them bad patterns. If you don't meet bad patterns, it means that your equation has finitely many solutions. These are dangerous patterns. Okay. And another useful result was given by Schinzel and Tiedemann. Fx is a polynomial. Is a polynomial have at least 2 distinct roots. Then, if a polynomial has at least 2 distinct roots, this means n can be bounded. N can be bounded, but this result is more powerful if you can prove that f the polynomial fx has at least 3 simple roots, then your equation has at most finitely many solutions satisfying n is greater than 1. Or if you can prove your polynomial has 2 simple roots, then your equation has finitely many solutions, but for the case n is greater than 2. Okay. Another useful lemma to prove finiteness of this equation, we need this lemma. This is easy. The polynomial gx, this polynomial, not polynomial, gx is equal to y to n. Gx corresponds to x plus 1 to the key, x plus 2 to the key, plus dot dot dot, plus lx to the key, gx, as you remember, gx polynomial corresponds to this expression. Okay, we proved that gx polynomial has at least two distinct zeros. Okay. And then another useful result, px, this polynomial, but here L is even. We proved that px has at least three zeros odd multiplicity unless q belongs to 2 and 4. We proved it. And another result, for any odd prime, at least two zeros of px have multiplicities relative prime to p. Okay. The idea for the proof of theorem, theorem 11 says this equation has finitely, not finitely, and can be bounded for the case n is greater or equal to 2. Yes. To prove this theorem, we use Schinzel-Tiedemann lemma, and yes, Schinzel-Tiedemann lemma, we use it. Yes, this is enough for proving this theorem. The idea for the proof of theorem 12, we use Brinza's result and lemma 12. Lemma 12 is this lemma. This lemma includes that px has at least three zeros of odd multiplicity and another case. Okay, this is my odd result and some ideas for the proof of main theorems. Last year, we considered this Diophantine equation again for the case L is odd. As you remember, TKLX polynomial, this is Bernoulli, Q, the Bernoulli polynomial here. As you see here, zero is a root of this polynomial using this expression. Then the multiplicity of zero as the root of TKLX is one if k plus one is odd and two if k plus one is even. Okay, firstly, we proved that the polynomial TKLX has at least three distinct roots. The proof is general, key is odd or even. This is general, it is easy using with my Italian colleague Daniele Bartoli. Okay. Our main result, with this result, we covered the gap on my odd result because we proved that the case L is odd. And we gave, here we gave general result. This equation has finitely many solution. Okay, this is last result. I would like to some clues about the proof. We distinguished the two cases, key plus one odd or key plus one even. In this case, we know that the multiplicity of the root zero is equal to one. Then you remember Brinza's formula. Brinza's formula, we get that T is equal to M. And then using Bernoulli equality, we distinguish two cases and does not divide key and does and divides key. In this case, we see that Ti, another multiplicity of the other root, is does not correspond to one, and this means the bad patterns in lemma, Brinza's lemma, are avoided. First term is n, the second term is different from one. I would like to go back Brinza's lemma quickly. Yes, this is bad pattern. Bad pattern, the first one is n, okay. The another one, the another parts of the tuples are different from one. So we don't meet these bad patterns. This means our equation has finitely many solutions for this case. And another case, in another case, n divides to key, all roots of this polynomial have multiplicity Ri divisible by n, then we have this expression. All coefficients of TQL x over this expression are rational. Fx also must have rational coefficients. So here alpha 0 is rational and alpha 0 to n is equal to this expression. Here we use an important theorem, the von Staudt-Clausen theorem. This theorem says that B key, if B key is different from zero, then two divides the denominator of Bernoulli numbers, but four does not divide. This is most important result for the theory of Bernoulli numbers. And then we will get that if there exists at least one root having multiplicity Ri not divisible by n, then the pattern does not correspond this n tuple. So this case is completed. Yes, this is main idea. Another cases can be proved using Brinza's idea and using binomial coefficient, von Staudt-Clausen theorem, and some elementary arguments in number theory. Yes, it was published in 2020 in Publicazione Matematica Debrecen. Okay, and then I gave with my colleague a computational result on this Diophantine equation, but L is 2. Previous results about the finiteness of this equation, but now I would like to mention about my old result. It was published in Journal of Number Theory 2018. I will give only main results because the idea was same with Haidu's paper. Firstly, we get some upper bounds which depends on V2, periodic valuation function V2 and V3, and then here, as you see, n is bounded by these functions. Here, and third case, okay. And then combining effective upper bounds are concerning n and Baker's theory, a result of Michel Laurent lemma, we have following results. This equation has no solution for this case. And then we proved that this equation has no solution for the case x is between 2 and 13. As you see, this is a hard problem. We proved this only case. Of course, someone can try to solve this equation in more general range, maybe using modular approach. For example, you can fix k. 2 is okay, fix, and is general. You can solve this equation. This is a problem for young researchers. Or you can consider this equation, n is fixed. This is a new problem I can suggest. Okay, but as you see, Baker's theory is of course good, but modular approach, modular method is very, very powerful to consider many type Diophantine equation, as you know. Okay, now I would like to give my new result, which has not been published yet. This is about on the power values of the sum of three squares in arithmetic progression. Okay, I would like to, first of all, I would like to give some motivation. Firstly, Kazel considered this equation in 1985. He proved that for the case k is 3 and n is 2. He proved that x is equal to 0, 1, 2, 24 are only integer solutions to this equation. This is the first one. And 2014, this equation was solved completely by Zhang for these cases by Zhang. He used, as far as I remember, he used modular approach, I think. In 2016, Mike Bennett, Vandita Patel, Samir Siksek extended Zhang result. They solved this equation for these cases. The same year, same authors considered this equation for this case. As you see, to solve these kind of equations completely is not easy. Maybe it needs new idea. Okay, Zhang, Kotsianas, and Patel studied this equation between these years. They considered this case respectively. Kotsianas and Patel gave all non-trivial primitive solutions to this equation where k is equal to 2, n is prime, but d is bounded. And another work was by was done by Garcia and Patel. They proved they showed that this equation they studied on this equation for this case. This case, k is equal to 2. Okay. In my new paper, in my new work, with my colleague Ma Huale, who is Chinese mathematician, about this equation for the case, k is 2. Kotsianas and Patel consider this equation for this case. P is bounded. But in our new paper, we consider this equation for a general P. P is not bounded. General D. Of course, D is prime power. And we correct, there was a mistake on Kotsianas' paper. There is a missing solution. Kotsianas gave this table for all solutions of this equation. But there is a missing solution. I will mention that. Yes, here we extend the recent result of this equation. We prove this result n is, suppose that n is odd prime and d is a prime power, if x and y is a solution of this equation, then p is greater than 3 and d is given by this formula. Moreover, this equality holds, then the solution x, y can be expressed with this formula. As you see, x and y. This is more general. Previous theorem gives the missing solution in Kotsianas paper where x1 is equal to 1 and is equal to 7. Okay. Another result, under the assumption of previous theorem, this equation has at most one solution. Another result, let n be odd prime. If every odd prime divisor P of D satisfies this congruence, then this equation has only this solution. Yes, the last result, we use Baker's theory. If n is greater than this number and d is greater than this number, then all solutions of this equation satisfy this inequality. Okay, I will give some fundamental notion for graduate students. For fixed integers, because we need them for proving our main results, For fixed integers a, b, c, the homogeneous quadratic polynomial f, x, y is called a binary quadratic form. This set here, this integer is called the discriminant of this form. Let d1, d2 key be fixed positive integers which satisfy these relations. These relations. Let h minus d1, d2 denote the class number of positive binary quadratic primitive forms with this discriminant. And we use this lemma. This lemma is given by Mahuale in 1995. This lemma says that this equation, if this equation has solutions x, y, z, then its every solution x, y, z can be expressed as this expression under these conditions. Okay, we need this lemma. Of course, this lemma is a special case of Mahuale's paper, which was published in 1995. And then we obtain this lemma, this equation, if this equation when n odd prime and this prime power p is greater than 3 a prime, this equation has solutions, then every solution x, y of this equation can be expressed with these relations. Of course, we use here we use previous lemma, and we can prove it easily by using Mahuale's lemma. Okay. I would like to define some notions. What is Lehmann pair? Suppose that alpha, beta are algebraic numbers. Alpha and beta, suppose that these relations are satisfied, then alpha, beta is called a Lehmann pair. And then we define ABC number using this number. We define AB is called the parameters of Lehmann pair, alpha beta Lehmann pair, using this formula. Alpha beta are algebraic numbers. They satisfy these conditions. Another thing, two Lehmann pairs are called equivalent if this relation is satisfied. Obviously, these Lehmann pairs, if these Lehmann pairs are equivalent, then this equality is satisfied where epsilon belongs to this set. Okay. Now we define Lehmann number. For a fixed Lehmann pair, we can define the corresponding sequence of Lehmann numbers by this formula. If M is odd, Lm alpha beta is given by this formula. If m is even, L m alpha beta is given by this formula. Okay, then Lehmann numbers are non-zero integers. Okay, now we give an important theorem. We use this theorem for solving many, many Diophantine equations. Let alpha beta be a Lehmann pair. A prime number Q is called a primitive divisor of the Lehmann numbers if Q divides Lm but does not divide this product. We say that a Lucas sequence is an Lehmann sequence is an M-defective Lehmann sequence if Lm has no primitive divisor. Yes, this is important. If Lm has no primitive divisor, we say that a Lehmann sequence is an M-defective Lehmann sequence. In 1995, Paul Wojtyla gave this important result. This result says that all parameters AB of M defector Lehmann pairs are given with this table. Paul Wojtyla gave it. And another the most important result was given by Yuri Bilo, Golem Hanrod, Paul Wojtyla in 2001. Every positive integer m bit m is greater than 30 is totally non-defective. Okay, I will give some clues for the proofs. We now assume that xy is a solution of this equation. Then xy and d satisfy this equation. Here we get p is 3, but we get 3 divides y with this equality, which contradicts these conditions. So we obtain that p is greater than 3. Using lemma 19, this lemma. We have this formula for x and d. Since this prime power, we obtain y1 is a prime power. We have this expression using this formula we obtain these equalities, and then let alpha and beta like this. So checking necessary results for Lehmann numbers, we see that alpha beta is a Lehmann pair with these parameters. We obtain AB parameters. And the definition of using the definition of Lehmann number, we have this equality. Therefore, we obtain this equality. We need two important tool. One of them, Wojtyla's results, which shows that at, which shows a table. You remember another result, Yuri Bilo, Hanrod, Wojtyla's result. Using two results, we see that n can be 3 or 5. Okay, we reduced to our equation to the cases n is 3, n is 5. So we are interested in this case. For the case n is 3, we obtain this equation. For the case n is 5, we have this equation. Using the properties of congruences and Legendre symbol, we get contradictions, and we can complete the proof of our first result, first main result. Using this result and by elementary argument, we can prove theorem 14. Theorem 14 says that our equation has at most one solution. It's okay. Our third result, we need Lemmer's lemma. If n is odd prime and q is a prime divisor of Lemmer number, then this congruence is satisfied. Using Lemmer result, similar to the former case, we get n belongs to this set, n is 3 or n is 5. Using similar step, we get contradiction. So the proof of our theorem, our third main result, is completed. Okay. Now, the last result was concerning we used Baker's theory here. So we need some definitions. Here we define absolute logarithmic height. Theta is, suppose that theta is any non-zero algebraic number with minimal polynomial over z is given with this polynomial. We denote by h theta is given this formula. It's absolute logarithmic height of theta. And then we use a result of Bilohan-Roth-Vautier. This result is based on Laurent's result. This is a linear form. This relation gives a lower bound for logarithm absolute value of lambda. We need it. For proving this result, we define d like this. Alpha and beta is defined like this. Theta is defined alpha over beta, and this is absolute logarithmic height of theta is given this formula. And then using Baker's theory, we are trying to solve some inequalities. Then we have this upper bound for y to n, so the theorem is true. And another case, if we assume that this equality using Bilohan-Roth-Vautier's result, we get contradiction and is smaller than this number. So we proved that if these conditions are satisfied, y to n is bounded this number. So the theorem is proved. These are main references. Obrigado pela sua atenção. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this wonderful talk. Let's open for questions and comments. Anyone?
Ana Paula Chavez, I know you. your papers, Ana Paula Chavez. Yes, you are studying on Fibonacci numbers, right?
Yes, I am.
Power sum with Fibonacci numbers.
Yeah. Indeed, I study. I like the topic very much. I would like to thank you for your excellent survey on the topic. I would like to request if you can. Surely, if you could send this presentation to us for further reference, there are many, many results that we could reference from your.
I cannot hear you. I think the connection.
Oh, sorry. Now you hear me?
Could you again, please?
Okay, so I was wondering if you could send us these slides for a further reference, because there are so many results in those. So if you could send it to MR and MR send it to us, I don't know, your slides with your, there are many, many results that we could refer to. So I would like to, if you could send us your slides.
Of course, I can send you.
Yeah.
Sure.
Nice. So I would like to thank you again for your lecture. It was very, very rich.
I have a curiosity here. This slide you are showing here. Why the equation ends on a multiple of x is a historical thing? You have here your paper, x plus 1 to the k, and it ends with a multiple of x, lx to the k.
Ah, okay.
Is this a tradition? Is a historical thing?
Actually, I was in Debrecen, in Hungary, 2013, my advisor was Akos Pinter. He suggested this problem to solve me. I stayed there 8 months. Uh-huh. So I was interested in that problem.
Okay. Any other comment or question? So let's thank Gökhan again for this wonderful lecture. I'm recording this, and I will send you the video for your approval. And if you accept, we can publish in our YouTube channel here of the Mathematics Department. Okay? Thank you again, Gökhan. So wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you again for the invitation. Okay. Come to Turkey, come to Bursa.
Oh, thank you.
I hope we can see the beautiful days, Corona.
Yes, Corona free.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Gökhan, again. Bye-bye to all.
Thank you, bye.